back to our intermediate financial accounting class. Over our last couple of sections, we've been talking about intangible assets, wrapping up our discussion of other assets, and finishing up our overall module of assets. So we've talked about the accounting cycle, we've now finished our discussion of the assets of a business, and now we're going to turn our attention to the rest of the balance sheet, talking about the way that we pay for those assets. We're going to break this discussion down into three pieces. We'll talk about current liabilities, and then we'll talk about long-term liabilities and equity. In starting this discussion of current liabilities, we're going to break it down into two pieces. We'll talk about determinable liabilities and contingent liabilities. Lots of fun stuff coming up. Let's get started. Now, why do we care so much about this? Well, first and foremost, short-term liabilities or current liabilities are the main factor in determining liquidity. And as we've discussed in previous lectures, liquidity is the primary financial concern of companies. If you're not around long enough to take care of short-term obligations, then you're not going to be around long enough to deal with long-term considerations, such as solvency and financial opportunities. So knowing how much we're obliged to pay is an important part of knowing if we're going to be able to pay those obligations. So we really need to have a good understanding of what goes into this current liabilities section. We haven't talked about contingent liabilities before. We will in more detail later, but in our increasingly litigious environment, contingent liabilities have become more and more important, both because legal liability creates some of these contingencies, and also because as we offer additional warranties and other obligations to people to generate sales in this environment, then we're on the hook for those obligations. And we're on the hook more so because of the litigious environment than we would be otherwise. So that's another reason why current liabilities are so important. Because they're so important, we use several different ratios when we analyze our current liabilities. And we've talked about most of these already. The current ratio, the quick ratio, cash flow to current liabilities ratios, all of these that we've discussed in the past are used to analyze these current liabilities because they are so important. They have a lot of ratios that apply just to them or have a direct application to them. The other thing we want to look at with current liabilities are strange accounts, balances that we just don't understand or account names that don't make sense, and then balances that are constantly increasing. Both of these, as well as the ratio analysis, can quickly show how a company is doing with its liquidity issues. So, very important topic because of its analysis ability, because of the information that's there, and because of the fact that as accountants, we're constantly called on to record these obligations. So there's a lot involved in understanding and using current liabilities. Walmart's been very successful in managing current liabilities because of their size. They generate cash so quickly because of their discount sales compared to other retailers that they're one of the few companies that have been able to keep a current ratio below one and still remain very solvent and very liquid. They don't get their liquidity by having more current assets than current liabilities, like most companies do. Instead, they have their liquidity by having a really high inventory turnover that allows them to produce a lot of cash very quickly as it's needed. So managing your current liabilities can be very important for companies as they try to successfully compete in the current market. One more reason why this is such an important topic. Well, what is a liability? Here's FASB's definition. Probable future sacrifices of economic benefits arising from present obligations of a particular entity to transfer assets or provide services to other entities in the future as a result of past transactions or events. Wow, that's really a mouthful. Perhaps an easier way to think about this is it's just what we owe to other companies or individuals or entities because of what we have done and are doing. And that perhaps is a simpler definition, but really it's an obligation to pay out some of the firm's assets. Now, especially with our simplified definition, it can seem really easy to classify liabilities. Unfortunately, as we get into reality and start looking at a company and its obligations, sometimes it gets really difficult to decide what is a liability and what isn't. So examples of these more difficult issues include deferred taxes, where I'm not 100% sure if I'm going to owe this or not. The equations are pretty complicated. We talked about them just briefly in relationship to depreciation. But because of all the different issues involved with taxes, it can be very difficult to classify, wait, is this a liability? Is it an asset? Is it growing? Is it shrinking? What's going on? So the calculations can be complex. Fun, but complex. And deferred tax liabilities are a great example of when it just gets complex. Another good example are derivatives. Derivatives are a special kind of investment
We only talked about stocks and bonds, but there's all kinds of other investments, and derivatives are one of them. A derivative is a way to hedge your bets. So if I'm worried about my interest rates going up really high, I might go get a derivative that would offset the potential increase in interest rates. They're really a very complex topic, and because they're dependent on the market, it's hard to decide whether we have a liability or an asset. So it becomes difficult not only because the calculations can be hard, like with deferred taxes, but because they're based on market values. And so this derivative can go up or down or back and forth depending on whether we owe money to them or they owe money to us as we try to smooth out our risk. And if that didn't make any sense, don't worry about it. Derivatives are a topic for advanced financial accounting. My favorite quote about derivatives actually came from a partner who was making a presentation at one of our Beta Alpha Psi meetings. And his comment was, you know, there's really only two people in the entire United States that really understand derivatives well, and you probably wouldn't enjoy lunch with either one of them. The other reason why it's hard to decide whether there's a liability or not is just the way we classify things. And the example that I have of this is preferred stock. Now, preferred stock is typically classified as ownership in the company. It's a special type of share, though. Preferred stock shares don't receive any voting rights. What they get is preference in the dividend paid out. And if the company liquidates, they get their money before the common stockholders do. Well, they're really not owners because they have no control and no voting rights. But they're really not debt because they don't have to be paid. If I don't declare a dividend or I don't liquidate, I don't pay them anything. So are they an equity or a liability? They don't really fit anywhere. And there's a couple of other things that are in this category where just, where do we put these? And that's the other aspect that makes liabilities a little harder than you would think when you just glanced at that definition. So keep in mind, liabilities are important. We want to have a good understanding of the basic definition. As a matter of fact, that definition, either the long one or the short one that I shared, is one of our key concepts for this chapter. But keep in mind, even with the definition, it sometimes becomes challenging to understand what exactly a liability is and when we need to recognize one. And that leads us right into our next category, and that is what kind of things classify as current liabilities. What do we have to put in there? Well, current liabilities formally are those liabilities that will be paid using existing current assets or by issuing new current liabilities. Another good way to think about this is that current liabilities are the liabilities we will pay off within 1 year or operating cycle, whichever comes first. And that matches them up with current assets really well. Now, there are two classifications of current liabilities. One is determinable and the other is contingent. And understanding the difference between these two is another of our key concepts, because it's really important as we go through current liabilities that you can separate the two different kinds. Determinable liabilities are those with specific amounts that are easy to calculate. I know for sure what I owe, and I know when I'm going to have to pay them. That's what makes it determinable. A contingent liability is up in the air. I either don't know the amount, or I don't know when I'm going to have to pay it, or I don't know either of those numbers. So I know I'm on the hook, but I don't know for how much. Let's talk first about determinable current liabilities, and here's a more formal definition. They can be measured with a fair degree of precision. We have a reasonably certain payment schedule. Here are some examples of determinable liabilities. And these are the liabilities that we typically think of when we think current liabilities. Accounts payable, short-term notes, dividends, unearned revenue, sales taxes, income taxes, the employee-related liabilities from our payroll. And then we typically see a current portion of long-term debt. Now, if we had unlimited time, we could talk about all of them. Unfortunately, we don't have unlimited time either to record them or to listen to them. So we're going to just take a subset, and I tried to pick a subset that would demonstrate the general principles of current liabilities so that you could easily apply them to types that we don't have time to discuss. So here are the four that we're going to work on. We'll look at short-term notes payable, we'll look at unearned revenue, sales tax payable, and then we'll look at some of these employee-related liabilities. Now, before we jump into our examples, though, I want to take just a second and talk about some IFRS differences. There really isn't a lot of difference between U.S. GAAP and IFRS for current liabilities, at least not for determinable current liabilities. They do require, however, that if you're reporting under IFRS, you include your bank overdraft as a current liability, even if you're not using it. Under U.S. GAAP, we require it, but only if it's material, and very rarely is an overdraft account material. So really, this is the only difference. I know it's one we've mentioned before, but I wanted to bring it up again as part of our discussion of the current liabilities. Now, we've talked about a lot of conceptual stuff. What we need now are some journal entries and some examples, and we'll get right into those when we come back. I'll see you then.